Today we're talking to Ben Dowman about his book, Adventures in Coaching. Welcome, Ben. Thank you for coming to the Berison studio.
Hi, Stuart. Thank you.
Obviously, I've read the book and I've got a few, definitely got some personal questions I'd love to ask you about the book. But the number one question for me really start was, kind of, where did the idea for this book come from?
So, about 10 years ago, I really wanted to write a book. And kind of had it in my mind that I want to write a book, I want to be an author, and even started writing something, and then, you know, it wasn't quite right, wasn't happy with it, so just left it, and probably about 5 years went by before I thought, actually, you know what, I don't think writing a book is something I'm going to do, and just decided to park it. So I was quite surprised when I woke up one day with the idea for a book. And that is pretty much how it happened. My initial idea was to use the story of the Wizard of Oz and to use Dorothy in the Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
And I've been mulling it over for a couple of weeks and kind of thinking, oh, I wonder if that would be an interesting idea for a book. And then one morning I literally woke up and thought, Alice in Wonderland. And went downstairs to start writing. So it was very much the idea just popped into my head, and I thought, I wonder if this would be an interesting way to approach coaching. And to
I think that's probably where the best ideas come from, aren't they? They just come into your head, you can't quite work out where they came from. Obviously, within the book, there's loads of examples of coaching in practice. You know, where have you gained some of those examples from, where those ideas come from?
So, I mean, I've been coaching people for 15 years. I've coached leaders, execs, I've coached people privately. And none of the examples in the book are based on any single person that I've coached. But they're really an amalgamation of the probably thousands of coaching conversations that I've had. And I would be writing the book and there'd be a coaching conversation with one of the characters. And I would just hear that person's response in my head, like the way that clients describe things. And, you know, I start to notice patterns in some of those things they say. And so people have told me that the conversations are quite representative and really good examples. And that's because they're based on, you know, lots of real coaching conversations.
I absolutely agree. I certainly know that there's been I've heard a few words coming out of the book and thinking, I've got memories of that happening, you know, so they are, I think, very typical examples. So Ben, the book isn't naturally an academic book. How was it you came around the idea of this particular approach to writing a book on coaching?
I guess I ultimately wrote something that I would want to read. Personally, I really struggle reading textbooks and handbooks and manuals. Much as the content is amazing, I find it hard to get through them. And some of the books that I have found really impactful are ones that have used a story to convey a message. So things like Who Moved My Cheese? The Tao of Pooh, The Tao of Pooh by Benjamin Hoff, that uses Winnie the Pooh to explain Taoism.
Yeah.
Some of the Ken Blanchard books that I read back in the 90s, probably like Fish, that everyone's read, they've got a story there and it makes it really memorable.
Yeah, I agree.
And easy to read. So I thought that's what I want to do. I want to make something that's really easy to read, that's fun, that's memorable, and you learn things through that.
Right. So Ben, obviously we've talked a lot about how you came to write the book, some of the background ideas to how it's been built. But tell me a little bit about what's actually in the book.
So the central character in the book is Alice from Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah.
And Alice wakes up one morning, it's the school holidays, she's feeling really unwell, dad comes in to check on her, and then she's just about to sleep. And when she wakes up, she goes for a walk, and she goes down to the river, where bizarrely she sees a caterpillar dressed in a suit who is upset about what's happening in his work. Alice talks to him for a bit and realizes she doesn't know how to help him. Mm-hmm. It's just about to leave, and there's a turtle blocking her path, a turtle wearing spectacles and lipstick.
Of course. Yeah.
Yeah. And the turtle basically says, well, aren't you going to help this guy? And Anna says, well, I don't know what to do. And the turtle helps her realize that maybe she doesn't, Alice doesn't need to give him any advice or tell him anything. Maybe she just needs to ask him some questions. Mm. And the turtle, who's called Rita, becomes Alice's mentor really throughout the book. And Rita is the experienced coach and teacher in the book. Quite early on, Alice meets a fish called Ronald, who's a manager in a bike company. And Ronald becomes Alice's co-student, really, because he wants to learn about coaching. And in some ways, Ronald represents the leader manager in the book. And some of his questions are around, you know, how do we use this in a work context, and how do I use this as a leader? Some of Alice's questions are more around general coaching with people. Mm. And the two of them go on this journey with Rita, discovering how to coach. Doing coaching themselves. At one point, Ronald gets a bit stuck with his coaching, so they go for supervision.
Yeah.
And they meet Victor the cat, who is a very old, wise, experienced coach, and he does some supervision with Ronald.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, the book takes the two of them on a journey, learning about coaching, of course, explaining a lot of key ideas.
I noticed when I was reading the book, you know, it seemed quite organic in how you moved from one lesson effectively to the next, and the next challenge or the next level of which they were diving into the coaching relationship. Did you have to wrestle quite hard with the order of those discoveries? Because it's not like writing a textbook where you're going to go, you know, we probably need to contractually decide how these things are going to work. Actually, it steps straight into a coaching environment straight away. So a lot of these things are caught up with as you go through the book. How did you come up with the order of those things?
I'm actually really fortunate because in the last however many years, I've done a lot of coach training, often with leaders and managers.
Yeah.
And so I have really refined the sequence that I think helps people learn coaching really effectively. So to some extent, I just was running that sequence of ideas that I've used in my teaching and training.
You use what you know, don't you?
Yeah. So I didn't have to think about the order that hard. It was almost like, well, this is what I would do on day one of my coaching training, and then day two, and so on. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I have to say, I think if I'd read this book, you know, 30 years ago, it would have brought my coaching on leaps and bounds much, much earlier and given me a much clearer insight to what I was getting involved in. I recognize that when you start off with a coaching career, it's not just coaching from the start. Coaching is part of other things. And so it is quite a slow grow. But I think what the book did for me was it did a really good job of displaying how complex, but at the same time, how powerful coaching can be. And I think it answers a few questions. So if you're ever thinking, you know, do I do coaching? Am I doing it all the time? Do I have the right skill set? Do I have the right approach? It's a great story for seeing yourself in the book somewhere. That was my experience anyway.
Interesting. That's a great way of putting it, Stuart. I think one of the things I've said about the book is that you don't have to be a coach to read it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You can be someone who is interested in having more coaching type conversations. So just being able to listen better, ask better questions, be a bit more aware of the dynamics that are at play in some of those conversations that you have. And that might be for people in HR, that might be for people in learning and development who just want to be able to understand a bit more about those things, even if they're not directly coaching people.
Yeah. Now, within the context of how the book is delivered, there are moments when you are the narrator within the book, but also at the same time, you discuss things and characters within the book while recapping on what's just happened and sowing the seeds for what is to happen. You know, was that always the plan to approach it in that way?
No. So the first draft I wrote was the story. So it began with Alice at the beginning of the story.
Right.
And, that was the first draft that I then sent to some friends and colleagues and I asked for some feedback.
Right.
And one key piece of feedback I got was that I needed to be in the book.
Right.
Because it was just a story. Well, just it was a story. And so I began to think, how can I bring myself into the book? And then I discovered this like really interesting idea of bringing Alice into the conversation with me, as if she and I are talking about the events that have happened, and then started to create this really fun dynamic between Alice and myself, where I position myself a little bit as being a bit more serious and Alice being a little bit more jokey, that kind of keeps everything
slightly juvenile.
Yeah, exactly. And so you know, one of the things people said about the book is that there's this kind of rhythm where it goes back and forth between something slightly lighter and fun and then the more serious content and the coaching ideas.
I would certainly say it does give a sense of depth, which adds bits to it for me. I did like that. I really enjoyed reading it. I found it was active, it was practical, and it's quite an honest thing, and I think that's where I sort of noticed, you know, shadows of how I've operated in the past. And I found that the process of reading it became quite reflective and almost a self-supervision process. Have other people given you that feedback or found the same thing?
Well, so I think there are different groups of people who might read this book. Yeah. There are people who are new to coaching and for whom many of the ideas might be quite new ideas that they're hearing for the first time.
That's true.
There are leaders and managers who might not want to be coaches, but might want to use a coaching approach or style, and for whom they might be familiar with some things, but quite a bit might be new. And then there are people like yourself that have got a lot of experience of coaching, and some of them have said that it has been a more reflective piece, or it's helped them think about the way they do things. And of course, they've met some of the ideas before, but actually some of it's just a different way of positioning the idea.
I agree, for me, it positioned several conversations I could reflect on from the past, and it unfortunately did enable me to realise there was more going on than I realised at the time. And as sad as that is to admit, you know, we're only human, but I definitely picked up something different from that. I mean, so I've learned some stuff from reading the book. I'm quite interested to know, actually, Ben, what do you think you've learned from writing this book?
First of all, I've learned that writing a book is really quite hard. Really quite time consuming, actually. Yeah. I guess I have a deep appreciation of what it takes anyone to write a book. You know, there are books coming out all the time, but I suddenly realized, wow, this is how much effort goes into a book. So that's one thing. That's a kind of a practical thing. I discovered some things about my own creativity, perhaps, in writing this. So my approach to writing it was, it's very different to how I approach many other things, actually. So I pretty much would sit down and write, and whatever came into my head, I would use that without censoring it, without filtering it, and without thinking, is this any good? And I think that allowed me to be way more creative than I might have done. That's quite an unusual experience for me. Usually I'm very aware of the words I'm using, and this was kind of almost just an unconscious download onto the screen, onto the keyboard, into the book.
Interesting, because I mean, my next question really was, you know, I know that you're an experienced user of NLP, very experienced, you know, and I was going to ask you, how have you found that balance or strike the balance between the language and words that you know tell the story you want to deliver, but also thinking about the words and the language you know reinforce people's understanding of the book and their own learning? Was there a kind of a striking balance there, or was that really just unconscious?
That was totally unconscious. I mean, I never thought about that, which to some extent, I suppose, shows the extent to which those things are part of me.
Yeah,
I mean, I literally just it just came out, and that's how it it appeared from my brain.
No, it's good, because I have to say, when I use the word, it felt honest. It felt honest because I know you, and so reading the book, you know, I could hear you coming through in the book, and you know, definitely wasn't somebody else writing it. So I love that. Sort of book I would certainly recommend that people would pick up, even if they're just the tiniest interest in actually would coaching help. And thank you very much for coming in and talking to us today. And we look forward to seeing your book flying off the shelves.
Thank you for having me.